U.S. Navy destroyers of the Arleigh Burke class are among one of the most successful classes of surface combatants in the world, with a strong focus on defending the aircraft carrier, the center of America's carrier battle groups. It is designed as a multi-mission destroyer built around the Aegis combat system. In particular, it excels in air defense, specifically area air defense of the entire naval task force. This includes specialized ballistic missile defense against ballistic missile threats. Anti-submarine warfare capabilities are generally delegated to their onboard helicopters on Flights 2A and Flight 3 of the Arleigh Burkes, which were redesigned with the addition of a helicopter hangar. The hangar is absent on Flights 1 and 2 of the Burkes. However, despite approaching one of the largest destroyer classes ever built, at between 9,000 to 9,700 tons full load, the Arleigh Burke does have a crucial weakness that may become more and more relevant as the naval arms race of the 21st century powers along. This crucial weakness is in the anti-ship domain, which affects the ability of the Arleigh Burke to fight independently of its carrier task force, especially when compared to equivalent destroyer classes and peer adversaries like China and Russia. For years, the primary anti-ship missile onboard the Arleigh Burkes was the Harpoon, or the RGM-84, which is subsonic and has a relatively short range at around 150 kilometers and an aging design. Nowadays, most Arleigh Burkes do not even field the Harpoon on a regular basis, leaving them without a robust over-the-horizon anti-ship capability. The Harpoon missile launchers are deck-mounted and are not integrated into the ship's vertical launching system, the VLS, which limits the number of Harpoons that can be carried and can be launched at an enemy warship. This is problematic because against capable modern destroyers with strong anti-air capabilities, a large number of anti-ship missiles are typically required to saturate the defenses of the opposing ship. And because the Harpoon are not integrated into the VLS, this necessarily limits the number of Harpoons that can be fired, which makes any resulting attacks by Harpoons easy to intercept for an opposing naval force with competent air defense capabilities. When the Harpoons were first introduced in the late 1970s, it was considered to be a highly stealthy anti-ship missile, especially compared to the larger and higher flying Soviet missiles at the time. Unfortunately, nowadays, with the development of more powerful ASAR radars and early warning systems, the fixed subsonic flight profile of the Harpoon is becoming more and more predictable, and therefore more vulnerable to interception by shipboard anti-missile defense systems, such as Sea Whizzers or short-range missile launchers. The active radar seeker of the Harpoon is also becoming old, making them vulnerable to electronic countermeasures and jamming. In short, the RGM-84, the shipboard Harpoon, is no longer adequate for the anti-shipping function of the US Navy destroyers. So why are the Arleigh Burkes so deficient in anti-ship and anti-surface capabilities? Well, the background to this is that the capabilities of the Arleigh Burkes was heavily shaped by the carrier-centric operational concept of the US Navy, where destroyers were primarily designed to protect aircraft carriers and the carrier strike group from air, submarine, and missile threats, rather than to independently engage enemy surface combatants. This carrier-centric doctrine led to the prioritization of Aegis air defense systems, anti-submarine warfare capabilities, and land attack capabilities, for example, through the Tomahawk missiles, over robust anti-shipping missile systems. As a result, the neglect of the anti-shipping capabilities for the Arleigh Burkes was, in a way, intended. The Burkes are escorts, not hunters. Their mission was to defend the aircraft carrier, not to act as independent surface combatants. This focus has created a defensive mindset in ship design and weapon loadout. Weapons were optimized for air defense. For example, in the Standard Missile 2 and the Standard Missile 6, and for land attack as embodied by the Tomahawks, rather than anti-ship roles. Training and tactics prioritized area air defense and ballistic missile defense, not offensive surface strike functions. There is also arguably an excessive reliance on carrier-based aviation for anti-ship strikes. The US Navy has long assumed that the carrier air wings would be able to provide anti-ship capabilities via aircraft, such as the Super Hornet or the F-35Cs. This emphasis on air-launched anti-ship missiles contributed to the neglect of shipboard anti-ship systems. This left the destroyers dependent on carrier aircraft for long-range ship killing, rendering the destroyers more vulnerable in independent engagement or in contested environments where the US Navy and the US Air Force do not have air superiority. Another trend that has been rarely discussed is that in the future, it may be too risky for the US Navy to send its aircraft carriers into the war zone, owing to the development of deadly land-based anti-ship missile systems. This includes the famed carrier-killer anti-ship ballistic missiles fielded by China, like the DF-21D and the DF-26, and the Zircon hypersonic missiles fielded by Russia. These land-based anti-ship systems create very potent and layered anti-access and area denial networks covering a wide area of the ocean. In such an environment, US supercarriers may be forced to stand off at longer ranges to survive, making their carrier air wings redundant to an extent as providing support to destroyer forces. So going forward, under certain contexts, the US Navy may be forced to fight a war at sea without their most formidable component, their supercarriers, to provide much-needed air support, and to provide the anti-ship functions that the carrier air wings have monopoly over in the US Navy. When fighting under the anti-access and area denial umbrellas of its adversaries, US naval forces may find themselves without teeth. So, it should be clear by now that it is becoming increasingly important for the Arleigh Burke destroyers to be able to fight independently of its aircraft carrier, especially in the anti-ship function. The US Navy has recognized this importance, and is beginning to experiment with a range of anti-ship missiles on the Arleigh Burkes to replace the aging Harpoon. One such option is the Naval Strike Missile, developed by the Norwegian firm Kongsberg. The Naval Strike Missile has a greater range than the Harpoon, as between 185 and 212 kilometers. It has a high subsonic speed at Mach 0.85. More importantly, it has a certain degree of stealth characteristics, with very low radar cross-section, and an even lower sea-skimming altitude than the Harpoon. It can perform evasive terminal maneuvers. Its stealthy design and terminal evasive maneuvers can make the naval strike more difficult to detect and intercept by opposing forces. It uses a passive imaging and infrared seeker, unlike the Harpoon's active radar seeker, making the naval strike more resistant to jamming and spoofing. Therefore, the naval strike does represent a significant improvement over the Harpoon in terms of anti-shipping function for the Arleigh Burkes. The US Navy has started to deploy the naval strike missile on at least some of the Arleigh Burke destroyers. In fact, the destroyer, the USS Fitzgerald, took part in the biennial Rim of the Pacific Naval Exercise, or the RIMPAC, off Hawaii in July 2024, carrying a modified naval strike missile launcher in the midship. The stealthy naval strike has been growing in popularity not only within the US military, but also with foreign navies as well in the collective West. However, while the naval strike missile is a major upgrade over the Harpoon, it still falls far short of peer adversary anti-ship missiles like China's YJ-18 and the Russian Onyx, in terms of range, speed, and raw power. And this point is often understated in Western defense commentary. For example, the naval strike has a maximum operational range in the low 200 kilometers, which falls far short of the around 500 kilometer range of the YJ-18 and the 600 kilometer range of the P-800 Onyx. While it is stealthy, the naval strike remains a subsonic missile, contrasting with the high supersonic speed for the P-800 Onyx of between Mach 2 and Mach 2.5, powered by ramjet. The terminal speed of the naval strike also falls short of the supersonic terminal sprint of the YJ-18. All else equal, a slower missile is easier to intercept in the terminal phase because it gives the defending ship more time to react. The naval strike also has a far smaller warhead compared to the premier anti-ship missiles of China and Russia. Crucially, the naval strike missile is not integrated into the vertical launching system, the VLS, of the Arleigh Burke, and, like the Harpoon, the naval strike remains a deck-mounted missile system, which inherently limits the number of missiles that can be carried by a destroyer. This means that the critical problem of a small salvo size associated with the current Harpoon missiles also applies to the naval strike as well, due to the lack of integration with the ship's VLS. Therefore, while the naval strike represents an interim solution to the gap in anti-ship capabilities for the Arleigh Burke, it is not a long-term solution. It does not equalize the offensive capabilities between the Arleigh Burkes and the surface combatants of Russia and China. Because of this, the US Navy is looking into the deployment of the Tomahawk Block 5A as a longer-term solution for the anti-ship function of its destroyer forces. The Tomahawk is traditionally a land attack missile, but Block 5A of the Tomahawk incorporates a naval strike function. The new Block 5A variant has a new seeker and software that enable it to engage moving targets at sea, making it the first true anti-ship Tomahawk. As with all Tomahawks, the Block 5A, the naval strike Tomahawk, is designed with a very long range in mind, dramatically further than the 150-kilometer range of the Harpoon or the 212-kilometer range of the naval strike missile. The very long range of the Tomahawk Block 5A substantially enhances the reach of the Arleigh Burke destroyers from what it's used to have. However, the Block 5A was only introduced in 2021. The vast majority of the Tomahawks in service in the US Navy are Block 4 or earlier variants, which are land attack variants, strictly speaking. Production of new Tomahawk missiles is slow and gradual, and it will take many years before most of the Arleigh Burke destroyers in the US Navy are adequately outfitted with the Tomahawk Block 5A missiles inside their VLS. In the meantime, they have to make do with either the Harpoon or the Naval Strike missiles as an ad hoc solution to their anti-ship function. In summary, while the Arleigh Burke destroyers are one of the largest and most effective surface combatants in service, they have a crucial weakness in anti-ship function, limiting their ability to fight independently of the carrier task force. This neglect reflects the carrier-centric doctrine of the US Navy, which emphasizes carrier aviation as the main offensive arm. The US Navy is developing interim solutions to fill the anti-ship capability gap of their destroyer forces, like the naval strike missiles, and longer-term solutions like the Tomahawk Block 5A. But these measures are not expected to rectify this gap in anti-ship capabilities for the Arleigh Burke for many years to come.